So I want to get to this whole quantum without quantum, because when people say something without something, like John Vervaeke is a philosopher, he says he wants a religion without religion. I always wonder, like, what are you referring to? Because if my wife asked me to clean up, I could say, yeah, no, I'm doing the dishes without doing the dishes. So to justify that usage, what is quantum without quantum? What's being saved? And what is the first quantum referring to that's different than the second quantum?
What I'm suggesting is that all the evidence on which quantum mechanics is based can in principle be explained in a completely different way without any wave function and without any Planck's constant. That is the, if you like, the outrageous claim I'm making. So what I certainly can do, I think I can make a pretty plausible case that there could be a completely different explanation than going on. So let's go back to the evidence on which quantum mechanics was based and what the founding fathers were trying to do from about 1925 through to about 1933 when the result was there. So what they were trying to do, almost, it was a huge role, was explain the structure of photographs taken in the laboratory. They were photographs of cloud chambers. So it's a wonderful story of how the cloud chamber was invented by Wilson, was the man who did it. And then he was trying to imitate, make clouds, things like clouds. And that was a cloud chamber. Uh-huh. And suddenly he saw these curved tracks. Suddenly he saw these tracks in this thing when it was in a metastable state. And he did the thing which made it then form all these vapor bubbles. And suddenly in the vapor bubbles, he saw all these tracks. That was the discovery of cosmic rays. But then the great mystery that they were trying to understand when they were talking about the foundations of quantum mechanics was to explain the structure of photographs taken in a laboratory. And in fact, all of the evidence for quantum mechanics. So I once did some practical work in astrophysics, which was to measure the effect, the spectral lines in the spectrum of a variable star. And what I was looking at through a microscope was a photographic emulsion, what I was looking at. And as I went along, it was where there was a double, where there were two spectral lines close to each other, a doublet. And okay, as you went along, it just got darker and darker. And then there was a place where it was darkest. That was the center of the spectral line. Then it went down again, and then it got darker again. So that was a photograph. I was measuring the darkness in a photograph. So that then was expressed in terms, that was the raw data. I call that the raw data, the evidence in the photographs. But then that was then processed data became interpreted in terms of frequencies and wavelengths. But when, think about Newton, for example, when Newton saw the colors of the spectrum on the wooden paneling in his room in Cambridge, the structure of the molecules in his retina were correlated with very subtle changes in the chemical composition on the surface of the wood. That's what was there. It was over a century before that was then formalized as wavelengths and frequencies. So quantum mechanics in that form was based on not on raw data but on processed data. And as I like to say, processed food is not good for us. So I think processed mm-hmm. data is bad for theorizing. So the Now, there is a completely different explanation possible for those cloud chamber photographs that Wilson obtained.
Okay.
Suppose that at the instant at which that happens, some deity could take a snapshot of the whole universe. And that universe satisfies just one condition. That quantity that I call the variety has a particular value. So suppose we have a universe with a trillion particles in it. Now, there's a huge number of shapes that will all have the same value of the variety, that can all have the same value of the variety. So,
right.
So there. So the deity takes snapshots of all of them. And then he looks carefully through all of them.
Uh-huh.
And then in one of them, he finds in a tiny part of it is exactly the laboratory where the photograph is taken and the photograph itself. It's sitting there. And the explanation is just determined by the statistics. There are probabilities of shapes. And the explanation for why that photograph is and the laboratory is in part of just one of those shapes is statistical, and the fact that the variety has a particular value. That is an explanation in principle. Now, this brings in the difference between holism and reductionism. The whole of physics, certainly since Newton, but before that, has been reductionist. All of variety has been washed away. Newton got rid of all the variety in his absolute space. And so what was left for these... It's very interesting to read the 1927 Solvay conference when all the great founders of quantum mechanics got together and discussed its foundations. They were all thinking in very reductionist terms. The furthest they would think about things would be what could happen in a laboratory. They weren't thinking about what the effect of the whole universe might have. But that's very critical, what the effect of the whole universe could be.
Dirac had his large number hypothesis.
Yes, but he didn't manage to go anywhere with it. But in fact, this is the sort of thing that is coming out of these ideas that we're developing. So let's just look at the let's look on page one on that extraordinary rich filamentary structure there on the right.
Mm-hmm. What are we looking at exactly? What was it that created these images?
That is just one, it's a distribution of the particles that has a value of the variety, which is what is said to be critical. It's either a local minimum or a saddle. So the value of it's a value of the variety, which if you change any of the particle separations by just a small amount, the variety doesn't change. That's a critical value. And that's the condition that has generated that thing.
Okay, let me see if I got this correct. So if we were to pick a variety number, remember the equation is above, let's say we picked variety 110. So there are a variety of different ABCs that you can put in there to get you the number 110. Now, if you look at these different numbers, maybe there's, I don't know how many of them, a trillion different numbers that can get you 110, depending on the amount of particles. If you look at it from a God's eye point of view, and you take all the snapshots of what can be 110, and then you say, okay, if I was to vary this, would that change my variety by much? Oh, this changes my variety a great deal. Let me go to the next one. And you keep doing that until you get to one that changes the variety the least. You're looking at that right here?
Yes, that's got to be the complete. It's not just one part. In that one with all those filaments on the right on page one, if you move any of the particles by a small amount, you won't change the variety. It will stay essentially exactly the same. All of them can be changed by any one of them can be changed by a small amount without changing the variety. That's what has generated that particular structure. And by the way, there's a huge number like that. It's, you know what factorial means. Yes. So essentially, the number of ones like that is 1,000 times 999 times 900, all the way down to one. It's just an incredible number of them. It's incredibly creative, this quantitative variety. But why don't we briefly turn over the page, because it's quite striking. So on page two, let's go to page two.
Before we move on to page two, what was the point of showing this? Like, what were you trying to convey on page one?
Oh yes, no, that's it. Yes, because there's a marvelous statistical. Do you see? If you could look at it with a bit of a magnifying glass, but you can see it with the eye already. All the smallest separations are almost identical. You can't. You won't find anywhere where two particles are really very much closer to each other than the others, and that's exactly due. That's because if you go up and look at the expression for the variety, it's 1/a plus 1/b plus 1/c. So if any of those a, b, or c goes to zero, then 1/ that quantity goes to infinity. So, and if you're fixing the value of the complexity.
Uh-huh.
That's you can't do that because you'll overshoot. So the explanation. So you will find it's incredible. All of those smallest separations are incredibly nearly equal. The smallest ones, and that is a holistic explanation. And by the way, it does exactly what the Pauli exclusion principle does in quantum mechanics. The reason a friend of mine, Harvey Brown, makes this very, very clear. If it wasn't in according to quantum mechanics, if it wasn't for the Pauli exclusion principle, if I just put my two hands together like that, there should be the effect of a hydrogen bomb going off. But it doesn't, and that's because you can't, in terms of position, you can't get two particles getting close to each other. It stops them doing that. But this is just this is one of the reasons why I conjecture that there is no quantum at all, because it's all just saying, if I specify just one value of the variety, and I've got to go through all values of, if I'm going to start from the lowest value and let it, the variety go on up, creating ever more different structures, and we'll look at that in a moment, I've got to fix each. So I call that the age of the shape. So the age is zero when it is at absolute minimum, and the age is slightly greater when it's above the minimum. So the difference between the variety at the value you've got and the absolute minimum could we have, we call that the age of the shape. That's my collaborator Tim Koslovsky and I. And that's really, if you think about it, how do you recognize how old things are? Well, I mean, just looking at you and me, it's blindingly obvious I'm older than you.
New update. Started a Substack. Writings on there are currently about language and ill-defined concepts, as well as some other mathematical details. Much more being written there. This is content that isn't anywhere else. It's not on Theories of Everything. It's not on Patreon. Also, full transcripts will be placed there at some point in the future. Several people ask me, hey, Curt, you've spoken to so many people in the fields of theoretical physics, philosophy, and consciousness. What are your thoughts? While I remain impartial in interviews, this Substack is a way to peer into my present deliberations on these topics. Also, thank you to our partner, The Economist.